Good morning. I want to thank everyone for coming out to the Special District Form 700 information session. I want to point out something really quick, and I want to apologize in advance if we do not have your packet. We are working on getting that together, and I do apologize for the inconvenience. We do have extra packets if you want to refer to that so that you can stay with us as there are presentation handouts and agenda and some other forms that we'll be referring to throughout the presentation. But we do have staff in our office working on getting the packets to you. So Brian is at our back table. Can you wave your hand, Brian? If you have not signed in and you have not picked up your packet, please do so. We do have your district's information in the packet as you have given it to us, okay? All right, so let's... It might be helpful to turn it on. Okay. So I want to introduce our speakers today. We have Krista Whitman, who is the Assistant County Counsel. Krista, could you wave your hand? And as I call the rest of you, please raise your hand. I'm Florence Evans. I'm from the Clerk of the Board's office. We also have Diana Richards. She's with the Clerk Recorder's office. We have Clarice Thomas, who's with the Clerk of the Board's office, and Stephanie Studert, who's with Clerk of the Board as well. I also want to acknowledge some key folks that are not here with us today. That would be the Clerk Recorder, Donna Allred, also Cindy Lee, who is the Clerk of the Board, and David Villanueva, who is our Chief Deputy CEO. Also, our project manager is Brian, who's been back there helping you guys get signed in and get set up. Without these people on this project, we would not be able to launch it as we have. We've already rolled out our county employees. We're doing our boards and commissions, and then our special districts. So I wanted to acknowledge them, because without them, we wouldn't even be here today. A couple of housekeeping things. If you need to use the restroom, the restrooms are located on our floor in the back on the south on the left side, both men's and the women's. If we have a fire drill, someone with a yellow vest will come out and give direction, but we'll all exit out of these doors here, and you'll get further instruction in terms of where we're supposed to be waiting until we get the clearance. So a little bit of background information. If you pull out your agenda, it's in your packet. There's some handouts in there for you. A little bit about how we've arrived at this point, and just kind of the importance of understanding some of the key topics that we're going to be talking about. Your conflict of interest code, the Fair Politicals Practice Commission is known as FPPC, and FPPC does require that local agencies have a conflict of interest code. And in your conflict of interest code, it should be designating positions that are required to disclose information that could be a potential conflict of interest. It also should have disclosure categories, which tells the filer the type of information that they should be reporting. And the way that the filer discloses this information is by submitting a Form 700, which is also known as the Statement of Economic Interest. So with that being said, you as the agency, these are the things that you're responsible for establishing and managing, and we partner with you in making sure that we're all in compliance. And the reason why the county is involved is because the Board of Supervisors is the code reviewing body of your conflict of interest code. So the board reviews your code, and it also approves your code. And once the board gives approval, the code then becomes effective. Also, with that being said, some of those positions, the Board of Supervisors is required to collect that Form 700. Not all, but some. This would be your department head or board members. Some of you may have employees on your code, and they're submitting their Form 700 to the county, but the county really is only responsible for collecting the Form 700 from a department head position or a member of a board, okay? That brings us to the e-disclosure system. So the county's responsibility is that they're the code reviewing body. We're supposed to collect the forms because we're the filing officer. We help manage that your conflict of interest code is kept up to date. So we have purchased an electronic system called e-disclosure. It's a system that has been approved by FPPC, and we are using the e-disclosure system to manage this entire process. That would be the collection of the Form 700s, as well as managing and keeping your conflict of interest code updated. So what we're going to cover today, and again, you have your agenda, we're going to talk about the legal requirements, and Krista's going to give that presentation to us. We're going to go a little bit into detail about just a quick overview on your conflict of interest code, your designated positions, and the disclosure categories. What should your conflict of interest code look like? We'll also talk about the roles of the filing officer, the official, and the filer. We're going to talk a little bit about electronic filing and what that looks like. We'll talk about some of the benefits of e-disclosure, which is the system that we're using to manage this process. We're also going to talk to you about things that we need from you, and we have already initiated that process, and thank you for those who have responded and is giving us the information. We're going to ask you to mark your calendars, because we have some really important dates that are coming up in the near future. And we'll go over some additional resources. We'll do a quick summary of what we talked about today, and then we'll open it up for questions. So I kindly ask that if you do have questions, jot it down, and then we'll address it at the end of the session. Also, in the invitation that you received, we did advise that we will be available to you today. If you want to stop by tomorrow, if you need to leave right after the session, we're available as well tomorrow for one-on-one assistance to you. So we have staff that's here and available, and we'll tackle whatever the questions are. And if you have unique situations, this is a time that we can talk about your membership, your filer information. We can also talk about your conflict of interest code, if that's the case. So we're here for you, and we want to work with you, and we really look forward to building the relationship and taking it to another level. And with that, I'd like to bring up Krista Whitman, who will cover the legal requirements.
Hi, as Flo said, I'm Krista Whitman. I'm the Assistant County Counsel. I've been working with the clerk's office for the past, what, seems like forever, year on updating the Conflict of Interest Code. My presentation is very short here today, but basically we were required to update the code every 2 years by FPPC regulation. And when we went into it, we realized that we needed to change some positions, change some disclosure categories. So this turned into probably a bigger project than it's been in the past. But I'm just going to go over with you just the basics of the requirements for Conflict of Interest Codes. So the Conflict of Interest Code, as Flo mentioned, lists designated positions and also disclosure categories. So designated positions are those elected or appointed officials or employees that are required to file Form 700s. And then the disclosure categories are what sort of financial information those designated positions must file. So the designated positions are those persons which have been determined that they make or participate in the making of decisions which foreseeably have a material effect on their economic interest. And we'll go into that a little bit more. But basically, that's the concept. So every employee within your agency should not be filing a Form 700, because obviously your receptionist is not typically going to be in the decision-making category of someone who's going to have their material economic interests affected. Then we have disclosure categories, and those are the categories, the type of things you have to disclose: real estate interest, interest in contracts, that sort of thing. So those are the disclosure categories. So the officials or employees that are required, that are designated positions, have to file a Form 700, which is the statement of economic interest, and that's an annual filing. Gets filed with the clerk of the board, as Flo will discuss further, I think. So the requirements are that there is an initial statement filed by anyone as soon as they, within 30 days of becoming a designated position, or when they assume office. It's called an assuming office statement. So again, within 30 days after their designated position, if a position has been designated, 30 days later, that person in that position has to file their statement. And then everyone who's designated has to file an annual statement by April 1st. And as Flo said, we're now doing the electronic filing, which is, I think, awesome. It's so much easier. And then there's also a leaving office statement. Again, anyone who leaves a designated position has to file a statement of economic interest within 30 days after leaving office. There's also some rules on resigning, but we don't need to cover those. So the general rule on adopting a conflict of interest code is every agency has to adopt and promulgate a conflict of interest code pursuant to the FPPC rules. A conflict of interest code has the force of law, and any violation of a conflict of interest code is enforceable by the district attorney, although I have to say I haven't seen that happen, but that is possible. Fines, investigations, all kinds of nastiness from the FPPC, and nobody wants to go there. So it's pretty serious. They take it very seriously. So for the adoption of the code isn't effective until the code reviewing body approves it, and the Board of Supervisors is the code reviewing body for the county and agencies which are wholly located within the county's jurisdiction. City Council is code reviewing body for city agencies, and then if you have a multi-state agency that has more than one city-county involved, the FPPC itself is the code reviewing body. And we do have that happen. I think Regional Sanitation District is within that category where FPPC is their code reviewing body because they're a city county agency. So you do see that on occasion. So conflict of interest codes must be amended whenever change is necessitated by changed circumstances, such as creating new positions, which have to be designated in the appendix to the code, and for relevant changes to the duties to existing positions. So if you had a position that didn't used to be in a decision-making role and now is, then you would need to amend your code to make those changes. And those changes are to be submitted to the board within 90 days of the changed circumstance. In addition, no later than July 1st of every even-numbered year, the county has to update its conflict of interest code, and agencies that have their own code must update their code as well. So this is the biennial update, and that's due by October 1st of each year. And again, I think Flo will probably go into that a little bit more. There's also some other processes where the code can be amended, but I think that doesn't come up often enough to discuss. So The conflict of interest code has to attach an appendix, and this is really the meat of it, which are the agency positions that are required, or the employees or officials that are required to file. And on these positions, it's those who are in a decision-making role. You also have to list those committees, board members, et cetera, that have decision-making authority. So if you've got a committee, board, commission, or another entity that has an ability to make a final governmental decision or can compel a governmental decision, meaning that they have a veto authority. They can make a recommendation that can't be overridden. Or this is the tricky one, if the board or commission over time make substantive recommendations that are routinely adopted by the agency, then they have that authority and are covered. And a committee, board, commission, or other entity doesn't possess decision-making authority if it's just researching a subject, preparing a report, recommendation, et cetera. So those are sort of the basic guidelines. I know that probably leaves more out than I covered, but that's sort of generally the law. It's fairly complicated. There are a lot of regulations that are very specific, particularly on the kind of interest that must be reported. There are some pretty detailed forms. The FPPC has a good website that has a lot of information, and for each one of them, when there's a question about what needs to be reported, there actually is a lot of information on the forms themselves explaining what sort of economic interests must be reported. So those can always be referred to. And if in doubt, you know, talk to Flo, and Flo can always come talk to my office if there's a question about that. But those get to be a little bit tricky, particularly when you have, every once in a while you'll have, typically an elected or something, that has some kind of complicated financial interests where they have ownership interests in businesses and stuff, and that can get a little tricky. All right? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Krista. Okay. So as Krista mentioned, there's a lot of components that go into the conflict of interest code and getting it drafted and things that need to be looked at and so forth. I won't get into the technical components of that yet. And the reason being is we will be hosting another training next year that will focus on conflict of interest code updates. But I want to get you prepared for that. So what I'm going to talk about is something that you should be receiving from the county is the biennial notice. As Krista mentioned, when you have your conflict of interest code, there should be review and there should be updates to your code because things do change. Positions change or get deleted or added. People are making different types of decisions and maybe they need to be added, or maybe their authority level has changed and they should be removed. So with that being said, the county does send its biennial notice out July of every even year. And as an agency, you are required to respond to that notice by October 1 of the same year. So we've been pretty successful with getting responses, but there have been a few hiccups. This last go-round, we asked agencies to provide a copy of the conflict of interest code because, as you know, sometimes what you have, we have different, okay? And the problem with that is when you're having your folks send in their Form 700 statement, the Form 700 statement is really governed and kind of driven by the conflict of interest code. So if you're asking an employee or someone who's been designated or that you believe has been designated, you should be able to look at a conflict of interest code, and that position should be listed on your conflict of interest code. So where we've found some discrepancies is we may have filers that aren't matched up with the conflict of interest code. And so this last biennial notice, what we had asked was that if we could get agencies to share with us what you have on file so that we can kind of do a reconciliation in preparation for the electronic filing, but more so that we could all be in compliance with FPPC. As Krista said, it is enforceable by law, and FPPC does take it seriously. So this is the means that you actually update your conflict of interest code. If you have changes outside of the biennial period, you can go through the process of having it reviewed by your board and forwarding that to the county, and then we go through the process of bringing it to our board for approval. We try to keep it in the biennial process, but FPPC regulations state that if the changes are significant, you can do that outside of the biennial process. The key here is the communication between the County of Sacramento and your agency so that we know that there's been a change. And the reason why is the annual statements happen every year. So when we're getting these annual statements, ideally we should be able to go to your conflict of interest code and say, oh, okay, this position is here. And if it isn't, then there goes up a red flag. Something hasn't happened. Either you have a new code or it didn't go through the final process. As we've already mentioned, the Board of Supervisors, per FPPC, is the code reviewing body. So we're the final authority on approving that code and making it effective. And again, your conflict of interest code, I can't express the importance of making sure that those positions are designated in the code. Also, the disclosure categories. One thing that we learned through our discovery getting prepared for the electronic system is that FPPC makes a lot of changes. So they have some changes in terms of disclosure categories, and we had to get up to par with our own conflict of interest codes for our boards and commissions and our employees because there have been changes along the years. So that forced us to take a look at our disclosure categories, and we now, I think we had 30 plus disclosure categories, and we're now down to 7 or 8. So it's also an opportunity for ways to improve efficiencies, okay? So now I'm going to bring Diana up, and she's going to talk about the roles of the filing official, the filing officer, and the filer.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. Like Flo said, I'm Diana Richards. I'm with the County Clerk Recorder's Office, and a lot of you have already communicated a lot with me over the years, and I apologize if that was not always a pleasant interaction. I try to be really nice, really. I'm here today to kind of explain to you the role of the filing officer, the filing official, and the filer, and to try to get us all on the same page so that we can clarify. In the past, I know we may have had some discrepancies in what we thought we were supposed to be doing, so this is going to clarify that process and get us doing a better job of communicating, and we'll all be on the same page and all stay in compliance. So the filing officer is the County of Sacramento. The clerk's office is responsible for that, and we are required to manage the Form 700 process to ensure compliance with any of the laws governing it. In this role, we are responsible for ensuring that the Form 700 is completed accurately and timely, sending out the biennial notice to the filing officials for code updates, processing any conflict of interest codes and their amendments for Board of Supervisor approval, and assisting you in managing your compliance with the conflict of interest laws and regulations. Which leads me to your role as the filing official. In the past, you may have relied on me as the filing officer to provide you with a list of filers, but I want to take a moment to clarify that responsibility. The filing official is a liaison between the filing officer and the filer, and you're going to have the most knowledge about your filers and know the intricate details of your filers. Each filing official is responsible for maintaining your district's conflict of interest code. This includes the disclosure categories and the list of positions, and then maintaining your filer information, which means you connect your filers to their positions. You keep records of their filer contact information, such as phone numbers and addresses, and then updating any assuming and leaving dates that you would have, and communicating those dates to the filing officer. And the reason why you want to communicate that to the filing officer is so that we know a leaving or an assuming statement is due. In the new electronic system, if we don't have that information ahead of time, they will not be able to file those statements. It's got to come first, that communication. So, and we'll go into detail that with that on more training. So we, as the filing officer, need to know that. So if there's any non-compliance issues with the conflict of interest code, as Krista explained, the FPPC is the one that enforces that, and our role is really just to assist you in staying in compliance so that we can stay under the radar on that. Okay, let's see. So that's another reason why we have asked all of you to give us your conflict of interest code. We've asked you to submit your list of filers, and then we're going to help you in connecting those with your positions that are actually in your district conflict of interest code, because those are the things that need to come together to be able to go into the new system so that we can be effective in doing what we need to do. So, and the other thing I wanted to recommend to all of you, I don't know if you've been on the FPPC's website. It is very well put together. It can be a little intimidating, but once you're in there a little bit and looking around, there's a lot of information in there that's very helpful and useful. They provide training. I believe they even do one-on-one training at the district. And all of us have taken several of their classes, and they've been very informative. So I highly recommend that you guys take a look at their website, and we have the links to that for you in there. And like I said, it's our job to help you guys with the process, so that's what we're here to help you do. And then, well, let's click this. Let's go on to the filer role. So the filers in the past don't think they have any responsibility. They think it's our job to remind them and babysit the process and tell them what they need to do. They're ultimately responsible once they're designated as a position that's required to file. However, because most of the time it happens annually, it is our role to support them, send out reminders. Me as the filing officer are going to remind you, which in turn you'll remind your filers. And the filers are actually responsible for three different types of statements. And I think this over the years has been a little confusing when I ask for an assuming or a leaving. And I just want to clarify exactly what those statements are. So in your packet, you have a Form 700. And it's got all this beautiful information that you should read in your spare time. But the main gist of the Form 700 is the cover page. That's one of the critical components of it. And this is the one that most times does not get filled out correctly. And our new online system is going to make sure this thing gets filled out accurately. So that's one of the benefits of this online system. There will be no more checking, did they fill out that box, and get it all done. So the first statement a filer is responsible for is their assuming office statement. And so in section 3 on the type of statement, they would mark the assuming and input any dates that they are responsible for or when they started their position. Now that assuming date could also be the date that they were added to your conflict of interest code. So if you amend your code, you decide to add a position, and you have an employee who's in that role, then they would file an assuming statement as of the effective date of that code. So it's not necessarily have to do with their employment times. Okay, so that's the first thing they're responsible for. And then second, each filer will file an annual statement yearly while they're in the role. So they'll do that every year. It's due by April 1st of every year. And it's just like taxes. So for 2016, they're filing their statements for 2015 and anything that occurred in that time. And on the statement, they would just mark the box annual. And it already kind of pre-fills in the date. And the reason why there's two options is because if they assumed office, it's going to say the period from their assuming date to the end of the year, not necessarily all the way back to January. So that's why there's two options for dates on that. And then third, they're responsible for filing a leaving office when they either leave their job, or the other reason they would do a leaving is if you amend your code to remove those positions from your conflict of interest code. So at that time, they would also be required to file a leaving office form. And there's this box on there for them to check and some bubbles they can pick to apply, because the leaving may be towards the end of the year and they only have to do that small window of time. So that's what they would have to do. And the other thing is the annual statements are due annually in April. And historically, we have been doing assumings and leavings annually too. And that's really not in compliance with FPPC rules and regulations. An assuming and a leaving office statement, they are due within 30 days of them assuming or leaving office. That's required. So we haven't enforced that as much over the years. This new system is going to keep us all on track and in compliance and make that an easier process, I think, for everybody, and eliminate all that paper. So ultimately, our goal every year is to get these filers to file their Form 700 so they're in compliance, which means you're in compliance, which means the county as a whole is in compliance with the FPPC rules and regulations. But occasionally, we're going to have the ones who will not file. They're not in compliance. It could be a miscommunication. It could be various reasons. They don't necessarily deliberately not file. There's many reasons over the years. And having to manage over 4,000 filers for the districts, it's a lot of people that can slip through the cracks. Things can happen. So our goal is to just get these forms filed. However, if we have to escalate it, it would be referred to the district attorney's office, but they're given ample time. So they have from January to April of every year to file their Form 700, and then they're given an additional 60 days after that before we're required to send them a 30-day letter. And then after the 30-day letter, there's a 15-day notice, and then ultimately it goes to the district attorney's office. And once they are late filing, the fine is $10 per day up to $100. However, the district attorney can impose a fine of up to $5,000. So we haven't, in my knowledge, ever had to do that. So that's a good thing. With all the filers, like I said, I've had over 4,000 filers. This year, I have an outstanding 80 filers at this moment, but some of that's miscommunication, some of it's some housekeeping issues, so it's, now's the time we have to just kind of clean all that, all the residual up, so. And let me see. So finally, the last responsibility of the filer is to keep their contact information updated. And this would include their phone number, their home address. Some may have business addresses if you have, you know, legal representation that's at a different address than where you're at. But most importantly is going to be their email addresses, because the new online system is going to rely heavily on email addresses so that we can maintain the electronic communication between all the parties and make this system effective and help all of us. And one of the things that's going to help all of you with is there will not be as much go-between the filing officer and the filing official and begging you to talk to your filers. The filing officer will actually send out the notice electronically straight to your filer. So you're not going to have that back and forth, you know, this person left, this person didn't. That communication will actually happen throughout the year, and that's what we really need to emphasize. We need to do a little better job of communicating throughout the year. It's not always easy, I know, but that'll help us with the annual process, and then it'll just go out beautifully. It'll shoot out to everybody. They'll ultimately file quickly in return within those first 4 months. And this system's gonna be set up so we can send out reminders. And we don't always have the time when we're doing paper and having to send letters and manually do an email and stuff to send out those reminders. And this system will automatically, they'll probably get a notice in January and then February, March, then they have to file by April 1st. So that's our goal. Those reminders do help. So we're hoping that'll keep us all in compliance, and it'll make your jobs a lot easier as well to keep them in compliance. So with that being said, I am now going to turn this over to Clarice Thomas, and she's going to talk to you more about the electronic system.
Thank you, Diana. Good morning and welcome again. Excuse me. Again, my name is Clarice, and I'm the one who's been hounding you about the spreadsheets lately here. So trying to get that information in that spreadsheet. And I'm really glad that you're here. I look forward to meeting you all, hopefully after the session. That way I can put a face with a name, since we'll be working closely together, and then I'll take over Diana's job of hounding you for information. Just kidding. As you know, the Board of Supervisors are the code reviewing body of the Sacramento County, And they're the ones who approved the new system e-disclosure. And that was done in 2014. And now what this system does is it streamlines the filing process, the filing process and submission of the Form 700. So it makes it easier. Take away all that manual, the paper. It makes our life much easier. Designated employees of the county actually started using this program 2015, just January 2015, and it's been nothing but good for them, nothing but positive reviews. So we're actually happy to introduce it to you all. We're looking for some good feedback from you as well. Thank you. Excuse me. We'll be offering a training session for the e-filing for the officials and the filers in December, this coming up December. And then the special district and the boards and commissions will actually begin filing January 2016. And these invitations will go out by email, so just make sure we have your current email address so that way you'll get the invitation. Also, invitations for the biannual update training sessions will go out in March 2016, and then the biannual update training for the filing officials will be in April 2016. Then the biannual updates will actually be processed electronically in July 2016. So that's our schedule there for those dates. So again, watch for your emails because we'll be communicating with you through the emails. Now let's talk briefly about some benefits. How does this benefit you as the filing officials? Well, first of all, it saves time and money, because again, we're gonna go from the manual to the electronic, so that takes out a lot of the paperwork. No more paper trails and stuffing envelopes and so forth. It helps you comply with the reporting requirements with FPPC, so we all stay within compliance. It also sends annual notices and reminders electronically. The filing officials can securely file and submit the Form 700 to the filing officer to us, and all that information is protected, so it is secure. And it also runs reports and tracks the filers from the system, so it tells you who's filed, who has not filed, and there's other reports that you can run as well to keep track of what's going on with your filers. Now, how does this benefit your filers? Well, they can submit their form 24/7 because they have access to the system 24/7, 24 hours, 7 days a week. So it's not limited to only business hours. They can do it from home, they can do it from work, they can be on vacation and still file their Form 700. It's a secure program. Again, the password is protected. So any information input into the system is encrypted. So it's very secure. So all the information we've been asking you for, it is protected. It's not for the public. It's protected with the system. Also with this system, they can easily amend their prior forms. It copies the information from prior year's form. So after they file for the first year, that information is saved in the system and then it's transferred over each year. So they're not constantly entering the same information over and over. It's already stored in the system. And also, it assists with accurately completing the Form 700. So the system will not allow the form to be submitted without being completely filled out. Missing information, it'll reject it and let them know. And then again, it saves time and money. Now, what we need from you. That would be the completed information request form. That would be that spreadsheet that I've been kind of hounding you all about. So if you haven't turned that into us, we'll need that completely filled out along with a current copy of your conflict of interest code. Again, we ask that you stay involved with your filers, making sure that the conflict of interest code is updated. If there's any changes, we need to know. and also make sure that all the Form 700s are turned in a timely manner. That will keep us all in compliance. Key dates. So that spreadsheet that was sent out to you, or you should have a blank copy in your packet, that along with your conflict of interest code is due back to us by August 5th. Again, we are requesting those for those who haven't turned it in, and then for those who have, thank you so much, appreciate it. Know it was a lot of work, so we do appreciate it. Again, training information and an invitation will go out in November, and that will be for the training in December. So that, again, that would be through email. So keep an eye out for that as well. And then the training will be for the filing officials and the filers. That will be holding in December. And then the biennial notice training provided to the filing officials will go out in April 2016.
Clarice, may I say something? Mm-hmm. I want to point out, too, that we do need a current copy of your conflict of interest code, and the reason being is it plays a critical role in the implementation process of getting prepared, getting the data input into the system. We need to make sure that what we have on file is reconciling from the Form 700s to the positions that are listed. Another very important thing is that if you don't have a current code, I don't want you to panic. We are here to help you. We're not going to turn you over to FPPC right away. Right away. Just joking. No, we want to continue working with you and build these beautiful relationships that we have. We wouldn't be here if we didn't already have a good relationship with you. We want to help you, okay? There are other large counties like us who have gone through this process. We've spent a lot of time and effort meeting with them, talking with them, visiting them to figure out what was the most effective way to go from a paper process, work with entities that are outside of the county's regulation. We can't tell you how to do your business. You have to do your business whatever works for you. So with that being said, we will work with you. Just give us what you have. What we don't want are things like a resolution that's not an actual conflict of interest code, or a bylaw, or some sort more so a code that you're using as a reference from FPPC or another state government code. We actually need something that speaks reference to a conflict of interest code with pursuant to FPPC regulations. And if you don't have it, that's okay. We'll start from scratch. We'll get it going. We'll help you. We'll partner with you. We have samples of other agencies that might be similar to yours where you can use it as a template. It's not that hard to establish, and we'll get you going, okay? So I want to point that out, and I apologize for interjecting, Clarice.
That's okay. That actually concludes my part of this session. So I'll turn it over to Stephanie, and she's going to go over the additional resources with you. Thank you.
Hello, thank you, Clarice. Hi, I'm Stephanie, and I'm going to show you basically kind of what the website looks like and how to navigate through it. Alrighty, and in your packet you have a resource page, and this is where you'll be able to locate the link so you don't have to quickly jot it down really quick. Alright, so let's go in here. And I understand that most of you guys can't see it, but basically if you just go to the bottom of the page, here we go, and if you focus on the middle, it's special districts related links. Here is the training materials. This is the PowerPoint and agenda from today, and the information session video. This is being recorded, so you can go back if you miss anything or anything like that. And the information request form, this is the spreadsheet that was emailed to you, so you have another blank copy of it that you can send to us. And the resource handout, this is the handout that's in your packet as well. And alrighty, and now I will give it over to Flo, and she will give you an overview of today.
Thank you, Stephanie. Okay, so it wasn't that bad, right? I think we're down to 9:43. We're almost done, but hopefully I just hope that you felt that this was worth your time, that you learned something that you may not have already known, that you know that we want to have a really good relationship with you and just kind of build it and take it to another level, that we're excited about our electronic system because it's really going to help with efficiencies. It is going to save time and money, and hopefully it will make your lives easier as well as ours. So we know that FPPC does require local agencies to establish a conflict of interest code. We've got that underway. We know that your conflict of interest code should have the designated positions. It also has to have the disclosure categories. The filer needs to know what they have to disclose. So that's in your conflict of interest code. We know that you take your conflict of interest code to your respective board. You get an approval, and then you forward that to the county, and it goes through the process of coming to the Board of Supervisors. And if you don't know, maybe you're new in your role, if you don't know, what actually happens is your conflict of interest code that was approved by your board, we actually put it on our agenda as a communications received and referred. We send that over to our personnel office, and they have staff there that actually reviews your code. And if they find that it can go forward to the board, we then bring it back on the agenda for the board's final approval. So twice, your amended proposed code is on the agenda for the County of Sacramento Board of Supervisors. So it's a public document. It's being seen. It's accessible by you or any other member of the public if they're interested. Did you want to get that? No. I'm just joking. I'm not, it doesn't bother me. So at any rate, I wanted to give you a little background information on that so that you are aware that this is a public circulating document, okay? The other thing is that our e-disclosure system, we are going to have the training in December, so I want to give you guys, just kind of put you at ease, because if there's something that you think that we didn't cover today, it probably was on purpose. We didn't really want to get into the technical aspect of the system, but we wanted to get you excited so that you know that it can run reports for you. There's going to be email electronic email notices that can go out, so you can kind of click a button and it has this template filled information, so you're saving time and effort hunting people down. You can communicate with us if you have a change. You'll be able to do some updates to your conflict of interest code. Another reason why I'm going to loop back to the conflict of interest code, and forgive me if I'm focusing on this too much, but what I think has happened and what we learned in the county through this process is that the update to the conflict of interest code and the collection of the Form 700s, they're married. One can't do one without the other. They are life partners. You cannot possibly know or require someone to file something on a Form 700 if they're not listed on the conflict of interest code. And if you don't have a conflict of interest code, you can't demand someone. What do you have to tell you that this person is supposed to disclose information? So maybe in 1977, the secretary was supposed to disclose information because maybe they wore a different role and they had some authority, but probably in 2015, it's different. I'm not going to say the entity's name, but I will say this. Sacramento County had a code that had last been amended in 1991. Okay, so we're just now getting around to that code and getting it updated and getting the proper boards and commissions that need to be on there. There are boards and commissions that no longer exist. So this is something that I'm sharing with you in encouragement that maybe you have the same situation. It's nothing to be embarrassed about. Just pick up your bootstraps and keep moving forward. Get the information current and let's move forward with the electronic system. We need that in order to get the proper and most accurate information uploaded into the database. We are comparing and reconciling from the Form 700s to the conflict of interest codes, okay? And then again, January 2016, we're going to expect the filers to file electronically. So that's a real big ribbon cutter event. We're going to get our members, get our filers. We've already got our county employees rolling, and we're at, I don't know, Diana, 99.2%?
Yeah, we're at 99% with right. our county filers. It's been very effective. Like I said, with your districts, I have about 80 filers that are still missing. So it's been very effective. The system has been well received by the filers, and I think the hardest thing that anybody's had with this new electronic system is the password. The password, I'm not gonna lie, it's not fun, and it's there for a reason. The FPPC wants to make sure that all this information is very secure, so they have very strict password guidelines that they required the system to have, and that means it has symbols and numbers and uppercase and lowercase. And that's hard to retype that into your system. So that was the number one complaint that we had. So I can take that. I can deal with that. So it's really nice. And they're able to give us feedback and send us notifications, which go to you as the filing office mm-hmm. official. And they can send, I can't get into this system. And they'll be frustrated. And you can just pick up the phone, call them. Usually if they hear your voice, soothes them pretty well, and walk them through the system and walk them through the password thing. And sometimes I've reset their password just to start fresh. So it's been very effective, and I know you guys are going to love the new system.
Thank you, Diana.
You're welcome.
Now it's time for questions. Yes. Okay, so the question is, on our form, we ask that you provide some personal contact information, and out of that contact information, can we omit the home phone number? And here's what we have to tell you. We know that it's difficult. We know it's hard to get this information. Some are less willing to give up that information. So just get what you can. The reason why we need this information is because, if you recall, we talked about the enforcement process. When we get to that stage, we are now going to engage with the filer directly to their personal home address and contact information, because, again, it could lead to penalty and fines. It's enforceable by law. So although we haven't done a lot of things in the past related to enforcement, I can tell you now there's a couple of things that will happen. We are going to get the district attorney's office involved. We are going to be rolling certain entities over to FPPC to help us if we can't work in relationship with getting a conflict of interest code established, okay? And the reason being is that we believe that even independent of the system, we really try to work with filers, and we really want to help people stay in compliance. And more so than anything, we're representing the County of Sacramento, just like you're representing your entity. And as far as we're concerned, that means we're representing the Board of Supervisors. So when something falls through the crack and there's a compliance issue, it's really a reflection of our board. So we're taking that seriously, and we're really looking at that, and we want to use the resources that we have that helps us keep us in compliance. And at the same time, you're going to be benefiting from that as well. So just try and get the information that you can. I will say, if someone has a question about email, I'm going to address that right now. You have to have an email account in order to have an account in e-disclosure. So for those folks where they just absolutely don't have an email, they're not computer savvy, we will have a workaround for that, and we'll go over that in very much detail during the training session in December. The reason we'll go over that in detail in December is because we want to put together for you something in writing, so you actually have a procedure that you can follow. You can amend it according to your own business needs and operational needs within your entities, but we'll certainly have something for you so that you know how to continue to collect that Form 700 and get it to us. Because there are ways outside of the system to do that. It's a little more work intensive, but there is going to be a workaround for that. Okay? Does that answer your question?
Yes, and I actually have people that actually only have those work phones. You know, because they are assigned a work phone, so that
That's fine. Whatever contact information you have in the, if you can make it very clear to us what that information is, we'll take that and we'll get it into our database accordingly, okay? One thing that I want to let you know, too, is that this membership form that we're asking from you, we're actually, what we're trying to do is assist you by doing the initial setup. So we're taking all of the information, we're getting it uploaded into the system as you give it to us, and we're cleaning it up as best as we can. And the only way we can do that is through you. Like Diana said, you're the filing official, so you are closer to the filer, you're closer to your business processes, you know when these people are coming and going, if they're your board members. So we're trying to help you by getting the information uploaded into the system so that come January, all they pretty much need to do is have a login set up, and their information is going to be in the system already. So this is helpful to you, it's helpful to us, and the reason why we've chosen this route is that the other counties that we looked at and that we're trying to kind of model ourselves after, because they've been very successful from Southern Cal to the East Bay, is that this is what they recommended in terms of being able to have a very streamlined way of getting the information into the system as clean as possible to kind of avoid some of the hiccups that they had endured years before we did, what we're embarking upon. Okay. Any other questions? I'm just going to go up like that. Okay. Okay. Yes.
So you had mentioned that this system is going to start sending out the emails notifying, okay, you've got 3 months from now, you've
yes.
got 30 days from now. Mm-hmm. So is that going to I won't have to monitor that as much anymore? I won't need to send out those 30-day email, the 10-day email?
That's an excellent question. The question was, since the system is now going to send out those electronic reminder notices, your 30-day, your 15-day, basically you're late, and the notices that are reminding them in advance, like Diana said. And I can tell you, we were kind of like the guinea pigs. It is annoying. I kept getting that email, January, February, March, and I thought, I'm not even at the deadline yet. So it really works. Do you as the filer have to do anything outside of that? And Diana, just interject if I'm saying this incorrectly, but from what I'm aware of, the system will send those out automatically to you. Now, you, as an independent person in your entity doing your own operational, you might want to go into the system and run a report. And the reason why I say that is you are closest to the filer. So you know when your board members are coming and going. There might be a meeting coming up, and you may want to have a little memo or something that says, hey, this is what we've got going on. Because for the County of Sacramento, we take it to our board. It's publicly announced that you are not filing, and we either need to get you off of a board or a commission, or we have, you know, these list of folks who are out of compliance. So that might be just giving you some ideas in terms of how you can get these people on board. Okay, so yeah, the system is going to do all that legwork for you, but again, the system allows you to go in and run reports, and you have access to this information. And you don't have to do it in a Word document and do a mail merge and pull your Excel spreadsheet or go into your Access database, which is what we do right now. And it is very, very time consuming. Very, very time consuming. So does that answer your question? Okay. I want to say one thing, too, and I didn't mention this. I want to go loop back to some of the things that we're going to do in terms of enforcement. One other thing that we're going to be doing is we will be taking a sort of a report, received and filed report to the Board of Supervisors every year, just giving them an idea of where we are, who are the entities that we've had to forward over to FPPC for noncompliance, and we're still looking at how we want to capture that information for the district attorney's office. Because we want the Board of Supervisors, as I said, to be aware of what we're doing to make sure that we are in compliance. So we're taking this very seriously, and we hope that you do the same thing. And I'm sharing this with you just as maybe some tools that you can put into process for your own public meetings that you have or other settings that might be appropriate where you could delicately, or if you need to go, you know, in a more stronger force, bring it to the people who have authority decision making, let them know what's going on. Okay, and you can be creative how you do that. It's not a matter of tattletaling. It's a matter of, I just want to keep you aware of where we are, because at the end of the day, that means you're in non-compliance with FPPC, and it is enforceable by law. Okay? All right. That way. Okay.
I just wanted to make sure that any emails that you send out to the filers will, for my district, will I also be getting a copy
We are confirming that. We know that there are some emails for sure, as the filing official, that you get. We don't have the exact list of what every action is, and we will get that out. We'll get that onto our website, as a matter of fact, and then maybe send an email out to everyone. The question was, does the filing official get copied on all of the email notifications that go out to the filer? So we'll put a list together for you and get that up on our website, and you can refer to that. And but we do know and can confirm that there are some notifications that you are included in. We just don't know exactly what that is.
I'll come up here with you. We do know for a fact that the annual notice, you won't get notice of that. Those emails that are going directly to your filers, you will not actually get an email. So, and the reason for that, do you want your mailbox to blow up every time we send a notice to your filer? I don't think so. Trust me, you don't want to, because I get them all. So, and that's one of the reasons why we are not doing that. But you will have access in the system to see what communication has been provided to a filer. This system tracks everything, every email, every phone call, every note. That's a good example of something. You're required by FPPC rules and regulations to keep track of every phone call and every conversation, and there's notes that you can put into the system to track that. And so then when we get, let's say we get to where we do have to report someone to the district attorney, all of that information is extracted to show here's what we have done to try to get this filer to file, and it makes it a lot easier. These reports we can print out, and I no longer have to scan the certified letter and all this packet, make this packet for the district attorney. It's going to come right out of the system, and it'll have your communication, my communication, anything that we've done. It's a little intimidating. It's not going to be as bad. Like I said, we had over 4,000 filers. It's kind of hard to get into a system and log every phone call that you may get. So if they call me about their password, of course I'm not going to note the system. Things like that. There is a problem resolution that they submit. I can't get into the system. My position's missing. That dialogue, you definitely will get an email on that. If they do a trouble ticket, basically is what it is, you and I both will get a notification that that has occurred. And then you can resolve it, or we can resolve it. We probably will have you resolve, and we'll give you some guidelines, what we want you to try to take care of. And then some things are gonna be out of your hands. You can't deal, you can't do that, so. Right. So the question was, can you see the Form 700 for your filers? And yes, you can see the forms for your filers. Those are saved in the system as well. Yep, and you can save them to PDF, any of that kind of stuff. Sort of, a lower level administrator. Yeah. We only have two administrators in the system, and that's gonna be my office, the clerk's office, and then Clarice will be the other administrator. And then January 1, when I pass the baton, we'll be down to one administrator in the system to kind of maintain the security of the system. Even our IT people don't have that access into the system. Of course the vendor will, but there will only be that. And you guys will have quite a bit of access, and we can turn on and off things for you. Some of you are going to want to get in there and do everything and help us maintain your filers to the highest level. Nancy, I know you're going to be one of those. So, and some of you might be intimidated and you're like, oh, I'm not comfortable, and that's fine. We're here to support that. So we'll give you the access you're comfortable with, and we'll work with that.
Okay, let me go up this way really quick. Okay, yes, ma'am.
It'll leave it blank. Let's repeat the question. So the question was, if they don't give us the information, are they going to be forced to do that? The first notice that we send is like a welcome to the system, and it's going to ask them to update any missing information in the system. It's not going to require that they do that. But we're hopeful that they will go in and update that system. This system is really unique. It's been a little crazy. The filer actually has control over what information goes on their Form 700. And their Form 700, once it's filled out, it'll show them exactly what's on it. So if they turn their home address on and it shows up on their form, we have the ability to turn that off. It's defaulted right now to only display the district's address. So their home address is on a separate area. It does not go into the Form 700 unless they purposely turn on that option and want it there. And you really don't want someone's home address there. This is a public document, so it's best to do the district. Even if they've left the district, still leave the district address in there. There's no reason to have their home address on their Form 700. You know, a lot of people don't like to have that information out there for good reason, and so that's an option. All right,
And just so that you recall, the reason why that personal information is needed is really when we're at that step that you're out of compliance and we have to show our due diligence that we have made every effort to get in contact with this person prior to moving forward with the district attorney's office, specifically for Form 700s. For the conflict of interest code, we can use the district attorney as well, but we would go with FPPC enforcement for that. So that's why that personal information is needed.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
I actually have two questions. The first one is, we're supplying the artistry board in our So that's the one. Is that going to be there for the first one you send to? Is that so that it doesn't go to the first one and become a open document?
So the question is, can they use the district email over their personal? And that is a definite yes. Here at the County of Sacramento, all of our filers are saccounty.net. Every one of them are. When we need that personal email address, and they can add it in there, but it's not their main login ID. The default, whatever you give us initially to set up the account, that's going to be their login ID. They can add a home email address into the back of the system with their other information, but that's not what's going to drive their ability to get into the system. Their email will never show on a Form 700 and anything. It's just a way of communicating. So if someone is leaving office, that's when you want to get their home email address so that we can update the system to be their home email address, and you actually have to reset their login ID to their home address so that they can access it from home, because they have 30 days to file. So. Call the DA's office. No, so the question was, what do you do if someone's terminated and you can't get that information? You get as much information as you can to the filing officer. We're going to send out the notices. They're going to ultimately be sent to the district attorney's office, and they will hunt them down. That's a good question. The district is not responsible for the fine. The fine is on the filer. They are responsible. So we all have our responsibility, but the filer is responsible for filing that form. Of course, we're going to manage it and remind them and do all that, but it is ultimately there. So the fine is their fine. Don't worry about it at the district level. You don't have to do that. And we rarely even collect a fine over the years. Like I said, our main focus is always just get the form. And I've gone months trying to get people. So sometimes it's not even possible to get a leaving office. If someone's deceased, that's a good example. You just let us know that. We do what's called an administrative leaving. It's just a behind the scenes. It doesn't file a form, but it gets them off the radar and closes out their account so that we can move on and not send out letters to maybe a widow or someone and, you know, perpetuate that. So we have that. Another thing that comes up a lot is people in military do not have to file, and we can put them on a hold while they are in active duty. So if they're not currently, and this happens in our county, we have a couple people who have been active duty for the last 4 years. So they're, of course, they're not able to file their Form 700. So we just put them in a hold status and monitor it each year, and eventually they either come back, or some of them are still active to this very day. So
I think this is where agencies should look at internal processes and maybe have something in place, work with your HR department or whoever it is that processes terminations, so that an example off the top of my head, what might work is a checklist, and the leaving office statement would be something that's on the checklist. You know, for us, we have a checklist when we're doing a termination of a county employee, and there's several things that have to happen in order to close out this employee. So maybe at, you know, something like that to look at, just a simple checklist, and you add that form on there. An example for the county is people don't think about the retirement. You don't think about the retirement and who you've last designated, or that the retirement has its own forms, and so just a simple checklist so that you know that as you're putting this person's termination packet together, you can check off that list and say, oh, this is a position that files, we need to do a leaving office, let's get that going, and however you guys do it, through the exit interview or whatever it is you do, and we know that sometimes there are sticky situations and you probably will never get a leaving office, we're all aware of that, but again, as long as we're in communication, we can do an administrative leaving office for you on your behalf. Yes.
What about for folks that that don't need to be filed with the county? Like, for example, I have actually quite a bit of Form 700s just for employees that are not board members or the executive director. Can I use that system for that?
So we knew that this question was going to come up. And if you recall, at the very beginning, I said the county is only required to collect forms from someone in a position such as a department head or a member of a board. And our board, we do have authority from our board to use the electronic system for any Form 700 that needs to be collected by the County of Sacramento. So what we're doing, what we're looking at, and we understand that this might impact some of you out there. And what I can tell you right now is that, yes, there is some discussion about a possible user fee and an administrative fee, somewhere between $5 and $10 a user. We're talking about those positions that the county is not required to collect a Form 700. So with that being said, there are a couple of things that you can think about. You can think about having a conflict of interest code for those positions that require the board's approval of the conflict of interest code, and maybe having a separate one for your employees that designate your agency as the filing officer versus the county. We know that we have a couple out there that have designated the county as the filing officer for board members, department heads, and employees, and we've been collecting those Form 700s. And so all I can tell you right now is where there is discussion about a possible fee, possible, and we'll have more information about that by the time we meet in December. And we're working with our CEO office and working with some of the other departments to work out those details and to determine if we even need to go there. Okay, because our goal is to work with you, and it might be easier to just leave it as it is, and as far as anything outside of that, we'll have a different process for that. So at this stage, we're in discussions. But excellent question, and thank you for bringing that up. Yes, and now I'll come down to you.
Hello.
Yeah, we'll do that offline, definitely. The reason why some of that happens, it may have got lost in the mail. I have new staff that has been helping out, so I have been trolling through your files and finding some that got filed and not input. So that's where I have to step in at this point. I have 80 outstanding filers, and that's what I'm doing. I'm pulling files. You're giving me a copy that shows that they filed, but for some reason we don't have it on file, or maybe we've misplaced it, maybe it got lost in the mail, so I'm working on that. But I'm required to send out those notices in the meantime, and then we'll get it resolved. Like I said, my goal is never to go district attorney, and we're going to make every effort to resolve it before then. Even if we ultimately, if you do have the copy, sometimes we have to just have them re-sign it and resubmit it. So we'll talk about that offline.
Yes.
That is a very good question. In my records that I have, we only keep 7 years worth of forms. Our database goes back even further than that, and no assuming dates, no assuming office was ever filed. So that's some of the discovery we have made through this project. It's like we haven't been collecting assuming offices religiously. We've been focused on annuals all these years. And part of the reason why is because this is an unfunded mandate. Nobody's being paid to do this. We're required by law to do it, but it makes it a little harder. So, you know, I've got a full-time job, and we've got to do this on the side. So we've kind of have misplaced things over the years. So no, we do not have those assuming dates. We're going to have to do the best we can with a date. Maybe make it effective the code, the last code that was.
I referenced the resolution, yeah. The last resolution that I have, but it might not be the
right. Yeah, so just do everything you can to try and get those assuming dates, because they are important in the system that they're in, something's in there. And even if we have to come up with a fictitious dummy starting date just so the system doesn't trigger assumings, because it will. If it's within 2 years, it will actually automatically trigger stuff. So we will just go back and put, we'll come up with something. I don't know, 1900. I don't know what we'll do. You've been around since then. Just something that we know it's a dummy date, not really a true date.
Can I just populate the date and I have
Okay, so the question is, do you need to have them file an assuming when you show that they have a missing? That would be no if it is older than maybe 2 years. Right now, I have been doing a little more cleanup with your files. You probably notice I've got some 2013, and that's because of this review. I'm noticing we're missing a few pieces. I'm trying to clean up maybe 2 years back, but no more than that. They've assumed in 2005, and we don't have an assuming. We're not cleaning that up. It's today. We're moving forward. So.
Yes, and then you.
Yes. Yes. Are you D. Hayes?
No.
Oh, okay. I know that district's very small, too.
Yeah. Our reclamation district is 800.
800, okay. Yeah, our reclamation districts tend to be the smaller and don't have as much electronic access, I've noticed. So, and that's fine to definitely use the P.O. box for your district address. Right. Yeah, we really do need those email addresses. I do have a few districts that have been bouncing back, and they are the smaller districts, and I realize that they're, you know, they don't have the latest and greatest in technology and stuff like that, and we'll figure out how we're going to work around that kind of stuff. That is really good. That's really good.
I can tell you from the county's perspective that if our board members do appoint members to boards and commissions and councils and committees, if you don't have your Form 700 on file, you cannot make a voting decision, period. You're in violation. So your vote shouldn't even count. So for us, we manage it very tightly. We have someone who, a deputy clerk, she isn't here, but she's been instrumental in this process as well. Her name is Lorraine Silva, and I don't know if any of you know her, but Lorraine is our boards and commissions clerk, and she manages that process very, very tightly. So the person who's assuming office is membership to this board is they're getting a Form 700 packet. They get a letter that tells them all of these things, including the fact that they are not able to participate in the government meeting until their Form 700 is on file. And I can tell you, we've had a situation one time where someone almost slipped through the cracks. And as a clerk, clerking various government meetings, it's imperative for you to know that because it can actually impact the way that an agenda item is going to, if it's going to pass or not, because their vote might not even count. Now, you as the clerk, you have to bring something back on an agenda. And how embarrassing is that to say, you know? But going back to making sure that we're in compliance, it kind of ties into that same thing. I know as the county, we are taking a very serious look at reporting economic interests and conflict of interest. Our clerk of the board, she's here now, Ms. Cindy Lee. Our clerk of the board has worked very closely with our districts, our board of supervisors, and county council. We've even revised our agenda so that, and our voting components, so that we have a recusal statement there, and we cite FPPC regulation there, because it is very serious. And if they come down on the radar or someone does a public interest, Public Records Act request because they're investigating someone, things start to get exposed. And what I mean by that is they start looking at who was responsible for doing what. Okay, so that's why I say that's probably an internal thing that you need to establish. And for our office, we do have a very tight control. Like I said, Lorraine Silva does a very good job at ensuring that our members who are appointed to boards and commissions have a Form 700 on file, and we have something in process to notify the governing board clerk that this person's Form 700 is not on file. And so we have to do some rearranging on our end.
I think to follow up to what you're saying is the member that's being appointed from the other jurisdiction to our board has one at their respective entity.
You would. Right, so that's where I encourage you when I said that you guys might want to look at some of your internal processes. And so for you, I would want to have a relationship with some of these other entities that make these appointments or changes that actually impact your conflict of interest code, and let them know why you need to know these changes. Because you also have a certain time frame to have your conflict of interest code updated as well. And we can talk offline, too. We like to help. just 1 second, and then I'll come back down that way. Yes.
I was just curious. Is this system now going to eliminate the fact that we need to have it recorded? So do I still need to take a paper copy and have it recorded?
No more paper. This means no paper. This means I really. So the question is, do you have to bring a paper filing down to our office and have it endorsed and filed with our office? No. The system will automatically tag the filing with a filing stamp, date, time, and our specific county code that the FPPC issued to us that shows that it came from this county. So yeah, no, there will not be anything. However, we cannot have a bonfire on January 1 and get rid of all our old paper. So if you have copies of Form 700, you're required to keep those for 4 years, a copy. The original you are required to keep for 7 years. So I will be sitting on your Form 700s for 7 years, and we will purge them. And 7 years from now, when I'm old and grayer, I'll finally be able to purge the last year. But yeah, exactly.
Bonfire party.
Yeah. And these are public documents. However, we shred all of them. I don't like to put that out there. Some people do have their home information, and if you do publish these forms, they have to have certain fields redacted. So we by no means just trash them. We do have them shredded and destroyed, just so.
The system does the auto redacting as well, so you'll love that.
Oh yeah, exactly. The system will, anything that you want redacted to publish, it will redact it for you.
Mm-hmm. We are required, I'm pretty sure, and you'll correct me, but we're supposed to have a copy of it in the office in case anyone from the public wants to come in and see that. But so I'll be able to print them from the system with that date?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great.
Yep, no more paper. No more paper, no more emails, no more nothing.
Okay, we're going to go back up this way. Yes, ma'am. If they don't have a Form 700 on file, no. And the reason being is, if we just think about this in practical terms, they could be making a decision on something that they have a conflict of interest, and so their decision shouldn't be voting on something. I'm just saying it in a way to help you think about this in terms of.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Okay.
Well, you can partner with the clerk of the board's office, and we will help you. And if we've got resolutions in place.
And it means file with you guys, right? Not like I can give them the 704 sign right there.
That's a good question.
I think they can.
We need to have it needs to be on file with the filing officer. a filing officer, which is the county of Sacramento, for those designated positions that are required to file, and the Board of Supervisors is the code reviewing body.
Okay.
Yeah. Good question. That's a good question. I'm glad that came up, because probably some of you aren't aware, or there are people in your agencies that aren't aware of that. And that's protecting that member, by the way, or that director or whomever is making those decisions. It's really protecting them. It's protecting them, because it just takes one person out there in the public, and Cindy can vouch for this. We have several of them who are watching. They're the eye watchdogs, and they are looking for everything, and they're very aware of every single government code and what is supposed to be disclosed and when and what date and the 30th day and the 31st day, and they're out there. So this is just protecting your filer. I can't tell you the code right off the top of my head, but we can talk offline, or I can email you. Yeah. And we, like I said, we can help you. We've got resolutions in place that cite the government code. Yes, ma'am.
How do you want to be notified of assuming or leaving filers?
Good question. Ideally, you're going to input that information yourself into the new electronic system, so it'll be a silent communication. So that is ultimately the goal, to do that. For those of you that may not have that kind of access or be able to do that, then you would communicate that either phone call or email, and then we would update the system on the back end.
Well, in that regard, then, will we be notified that they have filed so they can make decisions at meetings?
That's a good question.
Let me come back to you on that. Let me think about that.
Yeah, you might have to run a report to see who's filing. Mm-hmm. There's some very helpful reports, and it'll tell you, here's all my filers that are current.
As far as processes are concerned, like I said, we will, when we do our training in December, and for your question, like, this is something that we might have to put a process in place. Not might, we will have to put a process in place. When we have our training in December, we will address these things to you very clearly, because that did come up in our preparation here in terms of what actually will be going into the system come January. Are we doing just annuals? Are we doing the assuming and leavings? And so by December, when we have the training, it'll be very focused and very technical in terms of the steps that you need to take to handle the certain transactions related to Form 700, and we'll cover that one as well. So that way, this is great that it's coming up, because we had our thinking caps on for the boards and commissions for Sacramento County, and even in our discovery, we realized that there are some special districts that kind of have a interrelationship with the county as well. Because we had about 112 districts, and we got it down to about 92. So just to give you an idea of what we're looking at, we have several districts out there, and we've got about 67 boards and commissions. So so we'll address that in December, and then we'll get an email to you on the code. Yes. No.
No.
No. What we are thinking about is for the filers, and what we did for, we'll have a training session available. They're not going to be required to come to the training. As an official, we strongly encourage and almost want to call it a mandatory training for you, so that you are able to work in the system and be prepared for January. But for the filers, they will have the opportunity to receive training from us in person, but they can also go out to the website, and e-disclosure training that the vendor has is very, very thorough. It's very easy to follow, and we strongly believe that that should be substantial. You know, that would fulfill the need for them to be able to go into the system. And the reason why we stand behind that is because we did this model for our employees. Mm-hmm. And it's been very successful. Like Diana said, the only problems that were very consistent were the password issues. I, being one of those folks, having a difficult time with that password, with the lowercase this and the, it just, but I appreciate it because my information is in that system. So it made it very difficult for me to get in and out of it, but I got that resolved. So for the most part, it was just the password issues, a few other things that I don't think were related to the system concerns that people had. It wasn't necessarily related to the system. So the filers will have an opportunity to get one-on-one, hands-on training. I don't even want to say hands-on. It'll be in this room here, and we'll be doing PowerPoints and kind of going through the training that they'll have if they were to so choose to do it through e-disclosure through our vendor. And I believe that's where we landed on that.
Yeah, and the vendor has put together a really nice tutorial video for the filer. As a matter of fact, you can go to this very day on our website, look at underneath the county's links, and there is a filer demonstration video there. You can look at it to this very day and see what they're going to have to go through in e-disclosure if you want to get stepped ahead on that. And they can go through that video, and it tells them exactly what to do and when to do it. The problem is you can't force them to watch the video. So it's a useful tool for you to look at. There's a lot of times I'd have a filer call me, and the only way I knew to see what they're seeing is to look at this video.
To give you an idea.
Yeah, it's very informative, and it goes step by step. And like I said, when the filers ask me questions, I'd go here because you don't see what they see. Your interface is a little different than theirs if you're not a filer yourself. So as the filing official, you're going to see something different. I totally see something different as the administrator because our actual system looks totally different than the online interface.
Mm-hmm.
You can do this video at your board. Yeah, you can just bring that up and it'll pretty much do your training for you. And a lot of people did that. We had over, I think, 1,100 county employees. I want to say we didn't have more than 100-150 people show up to the training. I think it was the managers and stuff kind of did so they could help out. That came to it. Most of them did watch the video, and some didn't watch anything. They just called and complained and gave me a rank of 1 on the system. So they have the ability to rank the system. That's one of the things they do. And we ranking 1 through 10. And I loved everybody over 5 because our CEO, because we wanted to make sure everybody had a positive experience. Anybody that ranked us 5 or below, we were on the phone with them. What can we do to help you? And we'll probably do something similar with the districts too. We want everybody to be able to use this system and not get frustrated. It's easy to get frustrated with the new system. You know, I'm not that intimidated by stuff, but anything new is a little intimidating until you've been in there and kind of wait around in it a little bit and get a little comfort level. So,
as a filer, it was simple, lickety split. I went in and clicked a couple of buttons and submitted it, and I was done in probably less than 3 minutes.
Yeah.
So
they're not checking boxes on the form at all. Nothing like that. They're basically clicking, I need this schedule, or I need none of those schedules. They can do that. And it'll take them to the form, they view it, it's already filled in for them. Because we've already populated the system with your name and your position, your address of your district, all of that critical information. It already knows that you need to file an annual. And if you need to file a leaving and an annual, it'll ask them, do you need to file both? And it will actually marry those together and file the form for them. It does some really awesome things for the filer and makes it so much easier for all of us. And we don't have to do that review of the form anymore.
Once they get through the first year and getting their schedules and all of that information, some of that information always stays the same for them related to their properties or their investments. When they go in the next year, they're going to be in heaven because it's all going to be there.
Yeah.
You won't have to deal with those schedules anymore.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on 1 second. The lady in the white, did you still have a question? Okay.
Oh, okay.
Thank you for coming. Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, thank you. This young lady, I think, came on, was it your vacation?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. What a, oh, okay, what a trooper. Yes.
Just a real quick question. We were talking about me as the, like, as the official logging in, and I imagine you're going to go over how I'm supposed to log in the December training.
Yes.
Correct.
The December training will be very detailed for you as an official. We want you to be very comfortable as the official with the system. So,
and you will be able to have the benefit of us already going through all of this process with our own internal filing officials for the county. So we have personnel, a handful, that monitor their departments because we have quite a few departments, so of course we're not going to have one person updating all that, so we have designated. And we stumbled through that training because we all were brand new. We implemented this system probably in 3-4 months as far as the electronic part of it, didn't get a lot of hands-on, so we've stumbled through. So you get the benefit of all that growing pains we've already been through, and we'll be able to give you a clearer idea of what your role is and what you can do in the system and stuff like that. So you're in good shape for that.
So what I recommend to you is that you get in partnership with FPPC because they do offer training. We have all attended various trainings online, in person, by phone, by email, and they are very helpful and very willing to share information to help you get into compliance. And that really is the most appropriate place to begin in terms of telling what's your filer what they need to disclose. I don't know if you have legal counsel within your agency. No. So you would be best working directly with FPPC, having them help you. We'll help you as well in terms of looking at your conflict of interest code, because if you recall, the conflict of interest code is really what governs that. So we can help you outside of the process and before we get to December to look at what your code says now, look at what your disclosure categories are. And I can tell you, as the county, the employees, we updated that conflict of interest code in November of 2014, and the last amendment to that conflict of interest code was in 2008. And I think I have my boss's blessing to put us on blast, but the 1991 code that was outdated was the boards and commissions code. So it was a conflict of interest code that governs how our boards and commissions and members of those boards and commissions file and disclose information. So we actually updated the disclosure categories and we cleaned it up. And what we did in that process, including the county employees, because we all worked on the same team, what we did was we looked at other agencies in terms of a board of supervisors, a county entity. We looked at other counties that were similar in size and had functions that were similar to the way we do business. And we started there and we started looking at the conflict of interest codes that made sense. We looked at disclosure categories that made sense. And then when we narrowed everything down, the bottom line goal was, are we in compliance with FPPC? What does FPPC say in 2014? And so that's how we were able to go from 38 codes down to 38 disclosure categories to 7
Yeah.
And we decided to adopt the same thing for the boards and commissions. So it takes some work. You're going to have to do some analysis. And then we worked really close with FPPC. Anytime something came up and we weren't sure, because this is pretty complex, especially for us because we're dealing with so many different types of entities. We worked with FPPC, and I want to encourage you to use them and not be afraid of them, because they're very helpful, and they really want to get you on board as an officer or an official, and I would even go much to say as a filer.
Right.
They're very instrumental in helping you get on board and get your documents up to date. But as I promised in the beginning, our office, we're going to work with you on getting your, if you have an issue with your conflict of interest code, get with us. We don't mind helping you and getting you some templates or whatever we can do to get that going, and talk about some options in terms of enforcement.
And I just want to interject a little bit on your question with the help with that. Those are legal questions that you really should not go into with your filers, and the FPPC, like Flo said, they're there to answer those questions. That's their responsibility, because you can get into some really, they're going to depend on you to tell them exactly what to do, and you really don't want to do that. And with our filers with the county, I think the only thing that we brought up, because it's a big one that everybody thinks they have to disclose their personal residence, and that's one of the biggest, I don't want to do this. You don't have to file for your personal residence unless it is being used for business or in some way can create a conflict of interest for you. So for the majority of people, your personal residence has nothing to do with that. And so that was a big one. And then the other one was their retirement, was those investments that are being made through their retirement. Those don't count for the county. I don't know what the districts have. So you might want to get that question answered, because those are the two biggies, my personal resident and my public investments.
I've been very clear that I can't provide legal advice to them. Mm-hmm. But I have one filer that I know has a clear conflict of interest and won't report it, and I just cringe every time.
Yeah, and they're the ones signing the form. They're the ones saying that. So they're in violation if they're doing that. And the FPPC, I want to let you all know, we went into this a little intimidated by them. They're the enforcing authority, so you are, I don't want to tell them how bad we are. I don't want to tell them that we haven't done this in a while. They've been super through this whole thing. They're not here to get us in trouble. The FPPC does not go dissect your code. They don't come knocking at your door. It's when things come to light. You got those public entities out there that are whistleblowers and bring that stuff to light. That's usually when you get on their radar. But as long as we try to stay in compliance, we don't ever have to worry about those things.
As far as FPPC enforcement, what I learned through my research process, getting prepared for boards and commissions, is that some of the other counties out there had a few special districts that were really reluctant to establishing a conflict of interest code, disclosure categories, and these would be more, what was consistent is that these were the, it just slipped my mind, they're school districts, but they're, it just slipped my mind. It's a school that can be, charter schools, thank you. That seems to be a consistent trend, because you or I could go establish a charter school as it stands right now in California. It's not that hard. And so a lot of times what I found just talking to other county councils is that there was a little reluctance there, and maybe it was because they just weren't aware that they actually did need to have a conflict of interest code. You have a board, you have people making decisions about finances and so forth and expenditures. So the biggest thing as a filing official that you have to support your power or enforcement would be having a code that is up to date and in compliance with FPPC. And as far as what you're experiencing, this young lady here, knowing that someone has a conflict of interest, you know, all things come out in the light one way or another. And as long as you can show on record that you have done your due diligence, you've given them the form, you collected it by the due date, you've kept your conflict of interest code updated, it's been very clear to the filers what they need to disclose, that's really all that matters. And you're okay, and the county's okay, as long as we have that trail and we're showing that we're doing our due diligence. So with this electronic system, we think it will be very helpful and instrumental in streamlining that process. So.
Well, I had another thing that I wanted to share that I just thought of. One of the things in discovery that we found being so outdated and everything, and communicating with FPPC, there's been several lawsuits in the last several years, and they're on the FPPC website. One of them has to do with Monterey versus something, but these cases are cited on their website. And basically, especially for the county, we all erred on the side of caution. Let's all file so that we cover ourselves. Well, these cases have brought to light, you can get in trouble for having a filer disclose something that has nothing to do with their position. So what the FPPC is guiding us to do is they only need to disclose anything that pertains to their position. So if they have, example, stocks in Ford Motor Credit, but they don't do purchasing of vehicles for your agency, that wouldn't apply. That's not a conflict of interest. That's outside of that. So I think in the past, all of us have erred on the side of caution to cover, but that those cases have recently come to light, and they're really enforcing that and making sure we're not making our filers disclose stuff that has nothing to do with their positions. So that may be something you want to look at if you're going to be reviewing your code and get that guidance from them.
Again, thank you, Diana, because that really emphasizes the importance of the review of the code and making sure you have the appropriate designated positions and the appropriate disclosure categories. I know for us, we didn't have anything in reference to the consultants, so we had to add that disclosure category because that's something now that the FPPC has made very clear about. Another thing were the gifts, certain gifts that have to be reported, and so we had to add that into our disclosure categories. So if you want to take a look at what the county has, we adopted that on November the 12th of 2014. You can go right to our website and pull up the executed material. That's an excellent, if you want to use that as a template. Like I said, we went from 38 codes to 7 disclosure categories, disclosure categories. And what we did that was unique was we pretty much mirrored what the schedules look like. They're exactly what the schedules are. So as the filer is concerned, it's really simple. They're pretty much looking at the schedule and they're looking at disclosure categories, and we matched them up so that it would be easier for the filer.
So that being said, we did our code before the new system. So the system, the way we were used to it working, is we could have a filer, a position, and we could say, you need to do A, B, and C, or you need to do A, F, and G, if that's what it was. So we were attaching a code or a disclosure category, multiple disclosure categories, to one filer. This system does not allow us to do that. It's one disclosure category per filer. So what we had to do is, I think in the system we probably have 12. So we had to say, okay, if it's A, B, C, that's disclosure one. If it's A, C, D, it's disclosure two. So we kind of had, and we had a pattern, obviously, over 1,000 filers. We were able to dwindle that down to just 12 unique things to put into the system. So we'll be doing that and working with you guys if you have that same situation, is kind of renumbering or revamping your codes. And then that stuff, those attachments, will all be in the system that you can use in your future codes. So then you'll never have to think about that again.
That's what's coming up in March when we send out that invitation, and then in April we'll have your training on the biennial. That'll be a very comprehensive training as well, because we're going to be getting the system prepared to do the biennial notices and your code updates July 1 of 2016. So we are excited about that, sort of.
We are excited. Yeah,
it's just very work intensive, but it does give us an opportunity to build the relationship with you, put the face to face, come in and ask questions, and now you know where we're all housed, and so you can pop in at any time, and we're happy to help you. That's what we want to do, is have a good relationship, and like I said from the beginning, we just want to take it to another level and be in compliance, help stay under the radar and avoid lawsuits and embarrassing situations. And so do we have any other questions? Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so what I'm understanding that you're saying is if they're seated in December and they take action during that board meeting prior to them submitting the conflict of interest, there could be a legal matter because they vote.
Yes, for us, when we have a new board of supervisor, one of the first things that we ensure is that we have that conflict of interest code on file. The Form 700 on file. It's a little easier for us because we're sitting in the office and we're the filing officer. So it's and we have done it. Cindy can vouch for it, and the ladies here. We have done it where we're running around and making sure we've got it and it's endorsed, and we're getting it over to where we need to get it. FPPC is right down the street. So, but yes, technically they need to have that Form 700 on file with the filing officer. Correct. Now,
it's really easy to update the system. Like if you need to add a filer really quick into the system, as long as that position has already been established, and with your board, I would think that it would. You'll have your seat numbers in there. You just input brand new filer, and you could get them set up in minutes so that they can go in and electronically do it. You're done. And so you should be able to do it.
I think that's what we did for one of our...
You did.
We did for Patrick Kennedy.
Oh, no, he was paper. So
who was it?
It was Patrick Kennedy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We still hadn't had our electronic system up and running, so they had to do it via paper, run it down to my office. We're two blocks that way. That way? I don't know where we're at. And get it filed real quick so that he could take action. So, you know, sometimes you have to stop, drop, and roll. No, it has to be on file.
To the filing officer. We're the filing officer.
Electronically,
oh, yes.
Yes. So if they get it submitted and it says it's blessed and filed, yes, they'll be done that quick. The filer has to do it. The filer has to do it. However, as we know, some of those entities out there are bigger than that, and they have secretaries that do it for them, and that's fine. They're relinquishing their authority to their subordinate staff to handle that for them, but they're ultimately responsible for that.
And not to panic, but if there is one little workaround, not to panic, as long as you have a vehicle and you can drive safely to us for the meeting, you could print that out in the system for them, have them sign it. You would drive it over to us, and then we'll scan it again in the system. It's endorsed, and we're good to go.
Yeah, we could do that. We can upload paper documents, and we'll still be stamping them with the cha-chunk.
So we can still do that, too. We'll make sure that they're able to vote on that. Yes.
Person
We did. Mm-hmm. We did. That person, what you would do with, in that case is you will gather as much information as you can for that filer and forward it to our office so that we can then enforce the non-filing, and they'll just go through that process. You would just need to do what you could to get the statement initially, and that would be to get it updated in the system that they left. It'll automatically blast them an email. Now, if that email is no longer valid, it's gonna come back, obviously, but it'll escalate and it'll go through the process of enforcing it and just keeping us in the loop is. Okay, in that case, you are the filing officer and you would have to track them down and do whatever enforcement that you have at the district level. And I don't know where you would I bet you would escalate to the FPPC to enforce your non-filers as a district. We would not do your enforcement on anybody that was not required to file with our office.
So if they resigned, if it's one of our filers, meaning it's coming to our office, we collect that form 700, we can do an administrative leave. So for your own internal process, you might want to do an administrative leave where you can actually document that you're closing them out of the system and you have documentation, as FPPC does require that you keep a record of every phone call, note, or anything that you are doing in relationship to that filer. So you would do we call it an administrative leave of office, and so we're basically putting in our file, and what that means is to us, and what we're showing FPPC is that we've done our due diligence and we were unable to collect a signature from this person and get the form filled out by them, but we have done our due diligence, here's all of our notes, and we've closed them out of the system. For the leaving offices, you're not necessarily going to refer those over to being enforced. You just want to show FPPC what you have done, and that there is a paper trail that this person is no longer part of the entity or sitting in that position that is required to disclose information. So if something were to come up and somebody was questioning something that they were doing, you would be able to simply go to your records and show, I have an administrative leave of office on file, because this person's position was eliminated or they were removed out of that position and someone else assumed it, or it's been vacant or whatever it may be. The point is, the person in question making a decision about something that someone is questioning was not in that designated position at that time.
Okay. And it just means you weren't able to get the paperwork. Right. So you just want to make sure. If they never even took office, there's cases where you hire someone, they never even show up. Maybe they did their assuming, and then they're terminated, and they didn't do really anything. Maybe they're in orientation that whole time. They didn't do anything. So an administrative leaving, if you've done everything to try to get it, that would be something that you'd want to do. But you don't want to just use that anytime you can't get a hold of someone. You want to make sure you think about your exposure risk. You know, what were they doing while they were an active member?
Yes. Our agency changes titles frequently. Frequently. So are we going to have to do a leaving and then an assuming, even though the position is the same, the disclosure category is the same?
This one's the fun one. This is the fun one. This is when you amend your code to reflect the new name. Yeah, but they don't have to do a leaving. If they are in the same position and the title changes, they do not have to do it. Ultimately, if they're in the same, the county would be a prime example. I have an IT manager in our IT department and he becomes the director of IT, he really doesn't have to file a leaving and assuming. He's still within the same department, because the county of Sacramento wholly is really the agency. They never left the agency. They went to a different department.
Categories could be different from a manager to a
It's true. And that's one thing I have. If their disclosure categories change, you may want to do that assuming leaving kind of thing. But the system is not going to allow you to leave and assume the same position name. And the position name cannot be fixed in the system immediately. It's a process.
I have completed a leaving and assuming it within the county, mm-hmm. but this was outside of the system.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
When I've changed positions, but both positions required me to file, but when I changed positions, I did do a leaving and assuming because my disclosure categories did change.
Yeah, and this system kind of tracks for us internally. I don't know if you'll have much. There is a transfer option for County of Sacramento type people with departments. We have the transfer ability and it tracks that. So this disclosure category is responsible here. And I have personally not seen what that form looks like. I have it tickled for next year so I can see physically what a transfer statement's gonna look like in the end. But it does something in the system and maybe we'll have some better information in December. Something that we could actually look at.
90 days to get it to your board and then to get it down to us. And as long as it's within that process, within that window, because our board might not take action on it in that 90-day time frame, but as long as your board is making the amendment and approved the amendment and you've got it funneled over to us, again, in terms of enforcement is concerned, we are not going to roll you over to FPPC. If we looked at that and said, wow, this changed, you know, 5 years ago, and they're just now getting up to speed on that. We were in the same situation with the 1991 code, so yeah. We're more than merciful and willing to work with you, but per code, it is 90 days.
And if you're just gonna do a title change with no disclosure category changes, I would think, and you might wanna get guidance from FBBC, that's something that possibly could wait for your biannual to do that.
Because it's not a significant change,
and you only need to amend your code if it's significant. You know, if you have them disclosing the bare minimum and now they're doing full disclosure, stuff like that.
We have it stated in our code that if something does happen outside of the biennial, then that person will give full disclosure. So they're covered and they're expected to do full disclosure until we can get it amended and we can assign the appropriate disclosure category. Mm-hmm. And again, this just all depends on how you have your codes written. The FPPC is very good and has a generic code, if you will, for lack of a better term. And if you follow that, you'll pretty much be covered. Because it has language built in that speaks to that. And then you would simply then build your resolution around that for your board to adopt. Is there anything else? These were some really, really good questions.
Absolutely.
Okay, so we do want to thank you for coming out. We really look forward to working with you. We also want to make sure that you get acclimated with Clarice Thomas, who will be your primary contact in January. Right now, you're working with Diana and you're working with Clarice. You guys have had some interaction with her. And again, we do look forward to working with you and really want to encourage you to stay in contact with us, bombard us with the questions. The email address that you've been using to communicate with Diana and Clarice, they both are recipients of that and have access to that. And the phone numbers that you have. Stay in contact and just keep us informed and let us know what we can do to help you get through this. So if you need a code update, you need to establish a code, you can't find your code, let us know and we'll help you. We've got a lot of stuff in our records and we've been able to obtain a lot of data, but we're asking you to help us too. We're looking at about 150 different entities that have all of these filers, so we're already in 1,400 filers that we're trying to get information for. So that's the reason why we're asking you to help us, and if you've got a code, let us see it and let us work with you. Again, the conflict of interest code, I keep going there. You got to have that so you know who your filers are. Without that code, you simply do not know who your filers are. Okay. All right. So anyway, thank you. If you guys want to meet with us, does anybody have a need to meet with us one-on-one, or did we kind of cover that today? Okay. Yeah, we'll hang out. Yeah. And if anybody else needs a one-on-one, we can do it in the hearing room or we can do it right here. We just wanted to set up space to be able to accommodate you.
Yeah.
Hello.